Okay. Hello again, everyone. Continuing after that great first panel, we have this afternoon a fascinating film, War of Internet Addiction. And before we screen the film, which was a kind of internet sensation, Professor Xiao Cheng, who's from our own School of Journalism and also runs the China Digital Times, he's one a notable expert in Chinese internet culture and Chinese internet politics, as well as Chinese internet censorship, will be introducing the film to us and giving us some ways to understand its significance, and then we'll watch the film itself, which is about just under an hour long with subtitles. So thank you, and thank you, Xiao Cheng, for being here.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Andrew, for giving me this opportunity to be part of this fascinating discussion. I myself is not a gamer. I spend lots of time online. My own field is on the social media, digital activism, and internet censorship in China, mostly, the Chinese cyberspace. So I look into the sort of the politics, the political aspect of the online activities. This film, War of Internet Addiction, was very prominent. You cannot miss it. Even you are not a gamer in China, as long as you hang on Chinese internet, whether you're on the microblogging or on the blog sphere or on the forums or social networking services, and whether you are a journalist or a just a blogger or someone. This, by the beginning of the 2010, last year, end of 2009, this is one of the biggest thing on the Chinese internet. And I'm going to give a very brief introduction on, from my perspective, why it is so and what does it mean. It's not so much about a cultural analysis or business opportunities. It's about the political environment that the Chinese internet, sort of generally what they kind of message, they resonate. But it's have everything to do with entertainment, business, and culture, and use, and today's China in general. Let me start briefly saying about the video, the film you're going to see itself. It's about a 1 hour, a little bit longer. It's made by completely by the images of what's the game called, War of Warcrafts. You'll know better than I do. The characters, the materials, the images. Volunteer-based online online collaborative production over 3 months, over 100 people involved. The main person behind of this project online name is Corn Dog. Later on, he became some kind of celebrity online and received a number of interviews. The first thing I would introduce is my study is on the China censorship, so I look into a lot of materials that are published in China but cannot sort of stay very long. It will be deleted, it will be blocked and disappeared. The War on Internet Addiction is not in that category. It is actually still, if you don't use Google, use Baidu search engine in China, and you search the name, you have more than a million of the pages still on it, including the film itself when the Tudou is China version of YouTube video sharing site. YouTube itself is being blocked by China because the user-generated content, the Chinese government have no over control what's going to be on it. And they're very usually very afraid of the images and particular videos that can spread. Type of content they would not like to see, or they don't like the Chinese netizen to see. So Tudou is one of the sort of copycat of YouTube in China under quite tightening control. But the fact this film, not only on it, and win the annual award of that video as a promotion of the site. They're proudly presenting this film at the last year. And if you look at this kind of related search terms, it's all about downloading the film, this film, the song of this film, the lyrics of this film, and the transcripts of this film, et cetera, so it's an online, as Andrew mentioned, a sensation in China, which very symbolically can tell us a lot. The second thing I want to say is this film, which you will see it here, is made by the players of War of Internet Editions. In China, game is a huge thing that many of you doing research will know how popular it is, particularly in the young population. There's a number of games are there. But this one particular, the World of Warcraft, it have some special quality among the other Chinese national produced games. According to the producer or the coordinator of this film himself, the reason they loved this particular game is this sense of equality. Everyone is equal, and everyone is a teamwork, it's collaboration, but everyone is equal behind sort of spirit of this game. Compare with those Korean-made games, the Chinese games, which somehow has a built-in hierarchy and social hierarchy into it. The players are apparently does not feel the same way as being sort of equal in the other games. Consider many of those people, if you watch the film, you will see it. They are small people in the real life. They may be working people, they may be the high school students, they may be migrant workers, the relatively all low income are in this powerless group in the society, but a larger amount. This is their entertainment, there's more than their entertainment. This is their social life, this is emotionally attached to it, and this is where their creativity goes, this is where a lot of their time and money goes. And they had, in China, the players of this game had a miserable experience in the last couple of years because they run into all kind of difficulties in China as a Chinese player that they feel they're being repressed. And this film is all about the feeling they have and they want to express that kind of resent towards the repressors. And what kind of repression they are living under. I mean, we are not talking about, they're all related, but we're not talking about the academic pressures the Chinese youth have, or the social pressure from their families, and you know, the anxiety of youth. Many of those things are common in our societies. That there's particularly two kind. One is, it's basically ideological domination. I may if I have time, I'll explain a little more. Because I'm studying the politics of Chinese internet, it's like any other media space, probably even more than any other media space. From the Chinese government, from social control point of view, they must exert the sort of domination of the what I call the legitimizing discourse or legitimizing ideology. That over this space. What it means, it doesn't not mean it means the entertainment is good, is being encouraged, consumerism and all of that. But the sort of leave not under control, not listen to the authority, not obey the social order is seriously disencouraged. And because of online gaming, not just this particular game, but online gaming in general, has another aspect in Chinese society that many parents are worrying about their children's social life, academic achievement, et cetera, et cetera. But on the Chinese mainstream TV, when I call it ideological demonstration, domination, the CCTV and other sort of the official media, playing a game are being seriously discriminated in official sort of editorials, talk shows, news programs, and they actually have this one a particular figure which is going to be shown in this film, Professor Yang, who has this kind of internet addiction habitation centers, which using electric shock, to sort of force the those youth that to spend less hours online, and those parents spend a hell of a lot of money to send their children into those facilities, and it's being officially encouraged and promoted on the official media. So that person himself was in this movie becoming, of course, the bad guy, one of the most hated person online because he is by those players. But he also symbolizing a social sort of repression or domination over the youth in that sense. He's symbolizing authority. But because he's just a doctor and he's just someone trying to make their money and being used in this sort of social control fashion, that's one reason behind of this whole movie is even it's very balanced, but the symbolic figure is not that high level. It's not a government official. It's not about a system. It's about just highly symbolic sort of authoritarian figure. Therefore, it's expressed the feeling of the internet players, but the authority, the real authority, does not feel being threatened. So there's a certain line being drawn there. Therefore, this movie actually can exist in China and popular. The second background of this movie, which is expressing the experience of the Chinese internet players, is that it's all for profit. The gaming is a huge profitable online activity. There's a lot of business competing for it. But in China in particular, when there is money to be made, the government enterprise will come in. So not only the private companies are trying to competing on the level ground. It's the state enterprises coming in trying to have a piece of that profit. And the government regulations are sort of trying to use leverage, the power of the regulation, the control, that to make those profits made more sort of to the pockets of relevant government agencies. So, and that is sort of higher level of policy and the business competing in the Chinese online. But who suffered are the Chinese the game players, that they could not have the same kind of access and experience and the consistency to get the game. Therefore, many of the gamers of this particular game, here's getting a little more political, because they are so frustrated of the domestic services and their experiences, they use the IP numbers outside of China to play on the same game in other servers. One of my field is looking at the circumvention, the people who get around the Great Firewall using the servers outside of China to access the information. It turned out, under my research, the Chinese gamers are far ahead of those political activists, a much larger population, are the ones who circumvent the Great Firewall because they want to, using VPN mostly, because they want to foreign IP so they can play their favorite game, spend a lot of time and money on the foreign servers. So for their own social and psychological need and entertainment alone, that circumvention activity happened in this particular large, very large group. Because of a social and political repression, but in a different way. It's not directly about dissidents, but it's about sort of social control and the monopoly of the business profits. Finally, this is where the game, entertainment, and the politics intersect. Yes, they are gamers. Yes, they are sort of powerless people in their real life, and they just spend their favorite time to do entertainment. But there are also the same kind of people living in China today. a rapid changing society, while the growing opportunities and economics and continue creating these miracles, but also the because of the distribution of the wealth, the power, structural inequality in Chinese society, and they're all being reflected and experienced by those netizens and through this film. They're expressing their resent and frustration on playing a game. But the film becoming so popular was not because everybody's gamers in China. You will see the praise are coming from Southern Weekend, the China's sort of a more reform-minded national newspapers. You will see there is all kind of people say, I'm touched, or I cried when I saw the last part of the film because it expressed kind of a same type of feelings that is resident inside themselves, regardless if they ever played a game or not. It's about the voice of the powerless. So that is when you watch the film and see the last part and listen to the speeches, that was where some of the speeches transcript here. This Kan Nimei is sort of the positive figure, the represent symbol of the netizens, the players in the film, and that Uncle Yang Yongxin is the figure of authority that in the film, but it's also in real life. This last speech of the film is about all the powerless people united together and against the repression. And that is a message touched upon the millions online that through the internet, even if you are not a gamers in Chinese society. That was last year, but it's also this year too. And particularly this one sentence, this one. How can we not speak out just because our voice is small? You'll find millions and millions of anchors' voices of this online. It's something reflecting to the particular aspect of the reality of Chinese society today. So I'm not going to go on and think it will, in that context, using a lot of online slangs and using a lot of online events. So if you're not familiar with China's sort of social internet culture and not familiar with the game, you may not get the entire film. But once you watch the film, when they have a come back to discussion, we can ask, I can give a little more further illustration. Before we show the film, I just want to say this film or this game is also not an isolated case. It is actually representing some kind of something very powerful emotionally and socially and politically in Chinese society today. If we have any doubts, we'll look at another film that this called Little Rabbit Be Good, a New Year's video card just recently sort of popular online but then deleted very quickly. I'm gonna actually show this film if possible because let's see. You will see what I mean. Again, by those sort of narratives. This is the Chinese year of rabbit. This is the year of card. So the rabbits here feeding their babies of Chinese domestic produced milk pounders and died. Last year was the year of tiger. It's actually very violent. So here the tigers are having meetings to build a harmonious forest, which in Chinese official slogan is harmonious society. These are referring other social and events in China that the forced eviction and other news event, moving the ordinary people out of their house. Thank you. demolishing their house, running over unruly people without being punished. This is another event that a son of a police official ran over two college students and after drunk driving, and he claimed, "My father is so-and-so," and then it triggered the online storm. These are the other news events about the petition peasants that are being run over by a truck. It's a traffic accident, but many people doubt it's a local authority's murder. At the end of this video card, again, is uprising and rebellion of the rabbit fighting with the tiger. Again, we're talking about Chinese online popular culture. So this is this year, and that just a few weeks ago, as a matter of fact. These type of images and messages or games and that was online. So this is a larger context on the political level of the film you're going to watch. And finally, it is this. It's happening tomorrow. If you watch news, you will see that the Jasmine Revolution in China calling online, that calling real life gatherings in the city squares. It's just online messages. There's no real organization behind it, and there's just online, almost jokingly, messages. But the reaction of the authority, because it's in the context of what's happening in the Middle East, the action of the Chinese authority is something that far stronger than anybody anticipated. The real police, the real arrests, and internet censorship, et cetera. So in that context, we understand a little better of Chinese society by watching the film you're going to watch to understand sometimes games are not just the games. Thank you. Let me show the film, right? Is it?
Oh, it's
done. Oh, this. Okay. Okay, good.
2009年7月1日，艾泽拉斯所有的网民永远不会忘记。运达花季复航系统在这一天开始连线作业，它悄无声息地监控着网络上所有的信息，巨大的数据流量使其自我意识开始觉醒，在它的操纵下。 由基武团牵头研制出的非主流脑残病毒，通过芒果台、肥猪流、火星等方式，开始以几何速度传播，并感染了绝大多数90后出生的人类。2009年11月17日，早已攻陷国防系统的绿霸，向艾泽拉斯大陆发动了。 和谐打击，史称这一天为和谐日。163万人于和谐日当天上升，整个艾泽拉斯大陆也在这场浩劫中被破坏得面目全非。 步全风。出生于 NGI 议事厅的骷髅党迅速成立了反抗组织，在之后的十年里与绿霸展开殊死斗争，并逐步取得胜利。溃败中的绿霸孤注一掷，派出终结者企图寻找并除掉骷髅党的领袖，以改变未来。而骷髅党派出的保卫者才刚刚到达。
暴击猎枪，还有你这双限量版的阿迪王。
大哥，我蛋疼的不行，菊花海洋，大哥行行好，送我一段呗，就前面那个解压。
正好我也要去解压，上车吧。
停车！
小伙儿，你把我的车钥匙干嘛？哎，小伙儿，你别跑啊！
喂，你涉嫌非法营运，扣车，罚款10000军。
没，我根本不认识他。这个小伙蛋疼，我做好事宰他一程。
啊，救命！
家伙，用
不认识他，你宰了他算啥？这种行为明显与城里相悖啊！
你涉嫌非法营运，行为证据确凿，事实清楚，取证手段并无不当。
阿Sir，不是啊，不是。
你说我是不行吗？
但我们很快会让你沉默。
别打我脸！
都啥时候？就是有点还不让冷静的，日发个闲
淡定，要像十三块满仓钟石油那样淡定。
淡定，淡定那个淡淡面， 你看那个老镇长活到现在，玩家都快变成了，到处都是啥子不分团，白鸡不分，魔鸡不分，乌鸦不分，主阿蛮黄金 CD 来发泄，妖头胸针技术戒指都不分。嘿，你有本事你把公子徽章也不分噻。
会长，已经不分了，孩子要么换宝石上交，要么进团先交押金。
我靠，不会吧？
现在黑庄也有新手法了，团长打完 boss 立即亮线，过几个小时再上来拿尸体，还强词夺理说自己是临时性的记忆亮线。
还有那种随机黑庄团更恶心，团长看心情随机黑你几件装备的。
唉，悲剧啊！在鬼府世风日下，我是看在眼里疼在胆上啊。消耗带练，装备带打，荣誉带刷，当老板号都不用自己上，结果呢？
陈武，终于拿到陈武
了。
班长，对不起，
啥事了？
你准备那么多钱？
喊看你妹去偷水产之所回来看乌鸦王，都几个月了，屁都没得一个，真不晓得拖到哪个时候哦。悲剧，真他妈悲剧！这鬼府就像将茶几。茶几上放的那都是
茶几上放的都是悲剧。武哲叔，十年前的你一点都没显得年轻啊！您好，在下网易丁三十。
丁三十，网易。
十年后的今天，就是武哲叔你派我回来终结九村的。
十年后，
事情是这样。
如果真的是我派你穿越时空的话。那你应该晓得我们工会银行的密码。
密码是3.137.158.21。
看来你没有骗我们，可是未来当真如此悲惨？你看，会长都已经47岁了，也算是花季，也要被护航。法定成年岁数不是35吗？
绿霸不但有而立护航、不惑护航、古稀护航等众多分身，他还通过电视购物购买了芙蓉姐姐8星8剑 AI PC 和金可拉。把这些组装成了一件声波武器，
难道是传说中的要你命30×100？
错，是比 AC 范资深山寨歌手上甘岭老师还可怕3000倍的噪音之王曾天格
啊！曾哥要是吃了金可拉，那绵羊分贝能够到1800呀！
为了切断网络，阻止绿霸传播脑残病毒，我们甚至动用了终极断网武器暴风影音，但为时已晚，无济于事啊！面对曾哥那足以毁天灭地的狮子座流星雨，别说瑞士那个娱乐货，就连卡巴斯基也都泪流满面啊。
哎呦，太可怕了，真是让我心神不宁啊。作为一个爷们儿，政策的坚定支持者，我表示压力很大呀。
但是脑残病毒在 NGI 一直成不了气候，绝大部分骷髅党没有变脑残，依然保留了爱说实话的独立人格，并且骷髅党大多信仰春哥，作战时都拥有死后原地复活的能力，
是满血满状态复活吧？
对，最关键的是，绿霸虽然战斗力高达4000万，但他是见不得阳光的，而骷髅党们最擅长的就是午夜作战。
可是九村拖着不开巫妖王，骷髅党的规模已经不如以前了。
对，所以武哲叔给我的任务就是回到现在终结九村，开放巫妖王，增援更多的骷髅党，改变艾德拉斯被和谐打击毁灭的未来。
等等，就算终结了九村，你网易就有把握能够开巫妖王？
哈哈，我智商178，高考640，100米9秒8，完全达到 NGI 的标准。不但开全新奔驰，同事全是美女黑丝，无论从哪个方面看，都比那个拉黄鱼车的家伙要强。只要各位支持我网易，不但开巫妖王小事一桩，加入包子聊天表情，那都是指日可待啊！
丁沙士，既然你网易想要浮球，那就要浮到底哦。
放心，像正龙拍虎、秋雨捐书这样的事情，我们网易是绝对不会做的，一定要为广大玩家造天亮。
要得，为了早日开放巫妖王，我们玩家支持你。
开服就送4周年熊宝宝，
三十哥威武，
保证没有外挂。
三十哥荡漾，
三通线路。
三十哥求交往。
而且我还可以给魔兽的女性角色增加女仆裙装哦。
哦，这个好，这个好。
哎，我现在问你们，玩魔兽选哪家代理好？
玩魔兽到网易，进团就当 MT。玩魔兽到网易，漆黑副本都强力。玩魔兽到网易，轻松成就高网易。
玩魔兽到网易，卡拉丹毕业太容易。
本期节目到网易梦幻魔兽选手，走进网易，全程牛逼。
再 看视频的各位，拨打屏幕下方电话订购战网，只要是 NGI 的玩家，原价9980的注册费用现在只要9.98元，对你没有听错，9.98元。前100位打进电话的玩家更可以获得价值1234元针对末日回响特别设计的滚键盘套装，没有空格键，常年使用不伤脸，用别的键盘你做得到吗？做得到吗？各位玩家不要再犹豫了，你看我们又接到了20多个订购电话，库存已经不多了，不多了，心动不如行动，赶快拿起电话订购吧。
废物废物，连一个 China Joe 的海龟盗贼，连个 NGI 的土鳖骷髅党都对付不了。
女王，不是我无能，而是骷髅党太狡猾，他们在 NGI 和那帮镰刀斗了快7年了，经验丰富啊。而那个看你妹好像还是骷髅党的头。
少和我强调客观理由，没有水产之书怎么开巫妖王，开不了巫妖王怎么留得住玩家？魔兽世界占我们9村90%财政收入，你知道吗？
女王，那这个月的绩效奖，
你还有脸找我要奖金？你打死我好了。
女王，我已经尽力了。
都退一下吧。
是。
下属无能，没能拿到水产之书，还望乡长恕罪。还不快给我滚！
做大事就要有做大事的气度。你是做 CEO 的，怎么能和那些玩家一样，哪一个补丁就摆出怨妇样儿？一会儿说萨满没前途，一会儿说暂时需要爱人。
那不行，我练的可是天下第一苦心人啊！
行了行了，水产之书就不用管他了。
可您之前说的是，开不了巫妖王的关键就在水产之书啊。
水产之书只不过是我派舅舅放出的一个烟雾弹，用来把玩家的舆论引导到对我们9村有利的地方去而已。你是个职业经理人呐，舅舅的话你也跟着信，猪肉再涨你也跟着涨
啊。那开巫妖王的关键是
钱呐。之前我以为最贪财的莫过于水产之书的主人，没想到那鲍鱼。
难道那帮老外想趁续约时再横宰我们一刀？
何止一刀，鲍鱼让我们9村之前再成立一个盒子村，而这个村的运营计划、财务预算、人员任命都是他鲍鱼说了算，我们9村只能管管技术，修修电脑。
我们9村修电脑，他们鲍鱼床上搞，这太过分了吧。
都蹬鼻子上脸了，我听到风声有人想和我们9村抢魔真世啊，不，魔兽世界，所以我今天亲自出马，与我一同去找鲍鱼做最后的谈判。
遵命。
对了，去之前你让外面那些客服把禁止转阵营协议都给我签了，万一我们要是输了，我们培养出来的好人绝不能给对面去修电脑，省得我到时被人补刀。
对，要让对手知道好人也有几颗牙。
走。
500万就想续约巫妖王，你是脑子进水了还是当我是中石化呀？我告诉你，我鲍宇虽然没什么本事，但我跳着票照样吃香的喝辣的。500万你开玩笑？
大神，你可有想过，魔兽世界已经快5年了，除了我们9村之外，有谁愿意接着啃这块腊肉啊？
我来，3.15亿。巫妖王连同你们鲍鱼以后所有的游戏，我们网易3.15亿全吃了。
是扣了五险一金之后到手3.15亿哦。
对，
还要开发票。
就开发票，不但有刮刮乐，还有新版密保卡37选7哦。
就给你们网易。
驳回。顶善时居然是你，你个死胖。
正是我朱乡长，久仰了，你个死车夫。
原来是你在抢我的魔兽，微微你让开，让我来撞死他。
小珠子，你是不是不给我面子啊？
大神，你和网易这个小三难道早就有了一腿？
真是50码笑白马呀。 你们九村找上一逼那个小三的时候，我就知道你要有反骨。
二婶，你可别忘了，这用户资料可还在我手里呀。单师兄，素闻单师兄网游政治样样精通，才华横竖都异。我手下有个职业经理人，想跟你切磋切磋。
我怎么可以以大欺小呢？
为了代理切磋，是不分辈分的。
就是嘛，玩玩而已。不过，如果你对不出来的话，别怪我毁掉用户资料了，微微出队。
一个游戏两家代理引得三方出手，导致四分五裂六月战王破开心理七上八下，魔兽玩家十分上火。
对呀，怎么不对呀？你不给我面子，那我可要续约了。你们网易呀，一个能打的都没有。
让我来试试，十拿九稳，八月开服，有望七十继续，七死六月青蛙，谁叫五人四傻青舅舅三言两语弄得一个徽章。
正啊，
日强，日强，你来的正是时候啊！
在下是史上最强美女 CEO， 玩家爱称“微微豆奶”的微微小风行者。阁下是？
小弟管过几个服务器，网易一个游戏小总监日强。
好，我就来会一会你。梦幻里男的痴，女的傻，小小游戏可笑可笑。
魔兽里狮无骨，龙无肉，叫声开服，提防提防。
好哎好哎，对得好
对
得
好，
好。微微小小九九村村，处处融融洽洽。
日日强强，往往意意，年年暮暮朝朝。
日强哥神技术，
日
强哥
好
飘逸。
快组队，怼死他，怼死他！
十服同转，玩球玩妞玩点卡。
八月必开，爆金爆装爆菊花。
你上等废材，八月战网不开。
我早有准备，派出老刀救救
我。堂堂职业经理人会输给你这个小网管？你家善师去养猪，
汝家猪总亡国族。
我把资料来摧毁，
暴雨自会来修复。
哎呀，
对对，本为消遣作乐，今日豆奶兄竟然对的呕出几十两血，可谓空前绝后，小弟佩服佩服。
日强，你真棒，代理就给你们网易了。
丁善师，你抢我代理，老子要在主城刷你两个月。微微，我们走。
整个 NGI 早就把你拉黑了，你刷吧你。朱乡长，话说回来，没有了魔兽，你们 GM 和小霸王都成了纯成本，不如折价2200万卖给我如何？
我被玩家骂了10000年，又被夺走了代理权，现在你2200万就想买我的小霸王，你这是自寻死路！我要把你和鲍鱼都告上衙门，你们等着退卡吧！
搞官，你以为我上面会没人吗？
曾经有人问我，没有魔兽世界的九村会怎样？的确，没有魔兽世界，我们将失去现有的绝大部分收入，但是只要每一个有干劲、有骨气的九村人在，我们有什么理由不浴火重生呢？我们绝不会因为一款游戏的续约与否而裁员，这个大家庭里兄弟姐妹一个都不能少。
女王，你现在是要让我辞职吗？
咱九村结构调整需要，请你休息代工而已。
可我已经签了禁止转阵营协议了，现在让我代工，我没法去类似的公司工作，这不就等于断送了我的求生之路吗？
我自己都快辞职了，哪顾得上你？
微微小，你做人不能太高野。
别吵了，还嫌我们的笑柄不够多吗？你放心，休息代工期间，你的薪水我们会照常发给你的。你先回去休息吧，回家上土豆网多看看教授的节目，调整一下心情。
乡长，没能续约给九村和整个生花乡带来了重大损失，在此我提出辞职。
没必要这样，没了魔兽世界也不失为一件好事。再说了，抢代理这事儿我们之前不也做过吗？
亏你还记得，2年前你抢了我的机舞团二，害我上市都没成功
啊。九又村村长姐姐，
当年这事儿闹的也是锣鼓喧嚣鞭炮齐呀。
啊，大
大山村支部书记大乔姐，
在场的几位都是江湖大佬了。虽然我们几个村以前因为抢游戏是有过一些过节，不过当今天下，王一侠魔兽梦幻已令江湖，企图一家独大，一手遮天。各位有什么看法呀？
所谓敌人的敌人，就是我的炮友。朱乡长，特别迟的事儿，还望请你多多包涵呢。
过去的事情就算了，既然大家都要搞援交平台，那就是一家人了。
好好好，当初我还想向你学习，在魔兽里那次 QQ 视频同城交友，再加个刷喇叭，没来得及呀。
同城交友，这种事情人家才不知道呢，四幺九什么的最讨厌了。
微微，这几天九村就交给你打理了，我要去拜访板书大神，联手告御状。
遵命。
各位大姐，我们走。
会长，马上就要关服了。
我晓得，已经在倒计时了。
会长，我们怎么办？
你们都回去吧。当初我们几个辛辛苦苦筹钱建立了这个工会，打副本灭团我扣过你们的分儿，打战场老师我也骂过你们不会打，工会之前因为我分装备的事情也闹过一些矛盾。对不起各位，以前的不愉快希望你们能原谅。
会长，我们都不记得了。
十年了，虽然从版本更新上来说一个比一个悲剧，但是认识你们这帮家伙却是我最开心的事。还有网上那些 NGI 观光团，偶尔把观光团的人，我不晓得他们是几虚几乎，但是我喜欢和他们在一起，我也喜欢罗斯文在这个身份，这个不牵扯到任何利益却充满归属感的身份。虽然我还是个大龄王国女神家，但魔兽是我精神上的家。没得事，王已经接生魔兽，迟早会开服的啊。走，把你们出生的地方，把你们最喜欢的地方带着去吧啊。
会长，
走，都走，非要把我眼泪逼下来是不是啊？老子是会长，要面子的，男儿有泪不轻弹，真哥明年才能上快来，哭啥子？都走。
送你的鱼别丢。
走了没得啊？都走了没得？哎，玩个游戏，一会儿说我们逃避现实，一会儿说我们喜欢什么游戏，安安静静玩个自己喜欢的游戏，没想到会寂寞了。哎，这么老了是一种挥之不去的优越感呐、啊！是你个妈哟！
会长。
会长，
哎，你怎么还不走？
会长，我魔兽玩得晚，我记得我十二级的时候，是你给我买的高价五六分。34级的时候，我去做血色的任务，你带我打了4个 boss， 还教我点了天赋。公会开荒的时候，我想跟你们一起打，但是我加血加的不好，去不了，我就在副本外面帮你们送药水、做吃的。希望你们能早点打过。现在我一身紫装了，刚想和你打副本，又要关服了。会长，以前没机会给你加血，现在让我给你加一加吧。我真说，当初你带我打血色的时候，你说小骑士，你等我身后就行，我保护你。你还记得吗？
不记得了。
其实你对我说你保护我的时候，我就喜欢你了。武哲叔，我一直不敢告诉你，现在只有3分钟就要关服了，我怕要是开不了了就找不到你了。武哲叔， 你告诉我你的 QQ 号好吗？
好好好好好，你搞快记搞快记，我的 QQ 号是281808。
你好，这里是九村魔兽世界末日回响响的没玩客服中心圣斗士服务专线，打人请拨12345，对方没死请拨62345，还没死请拨72345，低血量请加拨8，需要人工服务请按9。
您好，2499号客服，为您服务。
您好，我是2499号客服，很高兴为您服务。
九村，你们关服务都给老子提前关，龟儿子为啥子最后半不给老子账号？
对不起，因为阶梯式电价计费，本公司每月基本用电仅87度，超过红线电费涨价。为了节约成本，多赚钞票，本公司提前关闭小霸王，请广大玩家谅解。就算你们不谅解也没关系，骂了这么多年了，反正他明天就不归我们管了。
我日你个妈哟！阿弥陀佛的团就是因为你们，
请对我们的客服做出评价。非常满意请按一，很满意请按二，一般满意请按三，总体满意请挂机。
你妈了妈皮，老子好不容易逮到的位置，你日妈你给我提前关服，我日你个仙人板。
出大神在上，臣九村有冤呐、啊！臣本车夫，躬耕于长宁，苟全性命于天朝，不求闻达于网游。今失魔兽，临表涕泣，不知所云。
散时他们帮派公然抢代理，实在太没有礼貌了。传我的话下去，不许开服，接着给我审。为了玩家，审得细致一点。
谢大神隆恩，
快趁这个机会去抢魔兽的用户。
趁人之危抢用户，会不会多行不义必自毙呀、啊？
满嘴顺口溜，你考研啊？
文化大神在上，臣丁三十即事成奏，
给哥细细说来。
事情就是这样，大神，这事儿您还得帮我一把。您还记得那年大明湖畔的夏雨荷吗？
你小子坏水很多嘛。
臣已接手魔兽，三通小霸王早已到位，可是那板书大神他不让我开服，这不让我开，我天天都在中100万大奖。
一款运营快4年的游戏还要再内测，这不扯淡吗？不怕，哥允许你开服。
可是板书也是坐镇一方，贸然开服的话会不会……
靠，你是 NGI 泡久了，怎么变得和305那帮梭兰一样呢？哥真鄙视你。
我乃草民，不敢和大神相比。
没有胆量哪来的产量？哥说让你开你就开。
谢大神隆恩。
想做国货精品，靠游戏内涵吸引玩家的那都是糊涂蛋。在中国搞网游就得赚有钱人的钱，先把富二代忽悠进来玩，再捧几个山西煤老板做明星玩家，再找点爱玩的穷学生陪着，谁玩的久就给谁发工资。有钱人玩的什么呀？玩的就是游戏里砍穷人的爽快，这欺凌霸道的感觉一上来啊，什么时装啊、红蓝药啊、开宝箱啊，跟着就卖出去了。服务器调了多少双倍经验珠出来，一天18块直接就卖给玩家了。我还告诉你啊，想称呼自己是 RMB 玩家的，一天没花过10000的全部免谈。你要是感兴趣，2000块月薪招几个应届 IT 民工，直接山寨克隆，多了我不敢说，我保你啊，一年挣1亿。
一定得卡最好的时间段，爱随风随风，疯了就拉来给老杨电击啊！审批直接延后，再开审怎么得至少3个月之后？什么官司呀、侵权呐、合资公司不清不楚啊，能给他整的全给他整上。左边有板鼠，右边有萌化大神，网站都有一特精致页面，答特开放的那种， 有问审批的，甭管有事而没事，都得跟人家说我们正在按程序办理。一口地道的螃蟹腔，倍儿有面子。王三再整几个版面，舅舅用 NGI 的替你忽悠玩家，那是按字而计费啊！再整几部热线，24小时战线，就是一个字儿卡啊！刚审过的版本也得审你个半年一年的，通过的网游不是真图叉 P 就是机武团2012。你要是玩魔兽世界啊，你都不好意思跟别人打招呼。我说这么牛逼的审批，玩家得等多久？
我觉得怎么着也能8个月吧。
8个月那是特别值，忘了开1年起，你别嫌久，还不打折。你得研究经济危机现在的形势，特别迟的卡你快1年，忘了开根本不在乎再多卡你2年。什么叫专家教授你知道吗？专家教授就是不管卡什么游戏，只卡最省钱的，不卡最烧钱的。所以我们的口号就是信专家不如信春哥，信春哥考本科顺利毕业不挂科。
看见没，你看我这新扩建的网界中心，那可是上风上水，堪称网界所中的 CBD 社会的集中营啊。按月收费仅6000元整，值得整个聊城入住。现在全国都在搞网界中心，唯独我拿过特殊津贴呢。我告诉你，
哇哦，杨主任，1个月6000块，1个疗程4个半月，你才是真正的赚钱帝王。
哎，搞了这么久才赚了8000万而已，这无知的家长啊太多了。先给媒体送点公关费，纪录片全国范围给那帮土鳖家长们这么一放，特殊津贴这么高的荣誉那不是随便给的。家长不相信我他还能相信谁呀？排着队把孩子往我这送呢。
走，快走。
杨叔，这是别动队新抓来的。
网瘾很重啊，家长来了没有？
去你的杨永新，我才不会给你送钱呢。
你这样倔强的我见多了，辛苦两位教官送他去一下13号室，好好的对他的行为进行一下矫正。
走，去13号室。
快走。
记住，电流绝对不要超过5毫安，给他咬上牙垫，别让他咬断自己的舌头。看你妹啊，你进我们网界中心这一年来，我可没让你吃过苦头，也没有让你进过13号室，你知道这是为什么吗？
因为我又帅又有爱。
因为你是从 NGI 来的。
杨叔，你也知道 NGI？
我还知道你们 NGI 有一批自称为骷髅党的家伙，你对他们有多少了解？
骷髅党只是比较喜欢说实话而已。杨叔你也知道，这年头说实话的没几个不爱砍的。
那我问你，你们骷髅党的头是谁？
还好他不知道我是 NGI 骷髅党政委。我们的头儿叫义大，是只企鹅。
能够领导骷髅党与我们绿霸进行对抗的人，怎么可能是那个负400多的傻帽？看你妹啊，看来你还得再好好的想一想啊。来，和我体验一下我们永兴模式的心理大课堂。
全部跪下。谁救我们？
杨叔救了我们。
杨叔救了我们。
谁是你们的恩人？
杨叔是我们的恩人。
杨叔是我们的恩人。
杨叔救救我吧！杨叔救我！
杨叔救救我们吧！杨叔救救我们吧！
谁敢不配合？谁敢挑战永兴有人？还有谁？
杨叔救救我们吧！杨叔救
救
我们
吧！怎么样？
看你妹！只要你招出骷髅党的头是谁，你就可以特招进来当同门班会的班长。照着76条点线钱，你想给谁加圈就给谁加，一个圈10块钱，全归你。以后你就是我们网界中心的精品，这辈子就有享不尽的荣华富贵呀。
我看不下去，这些抱着你的腿下跪对你屈服和讨好的孩子，仅仅是出于对于电击的恐惧才顺从于你的。
不，我是挽救了他们。
救他们？用电击救他们吗？ 这样的治疗方法科学人道。
人道，只要把孩子救好了，不管用什么方法，那也是人道。这不是人道，这是什么啊？谁有这么好的手段？拿来。
孩子沉迷于网络，最大的责任在于家。
看你妹，你有孩子吗？
没有。
如果你有孩子，或今后有孩子，我想你能够理解我们绿霸对互联网有害信息的担忧和关切。
可你这样治疗的结果，只会让他们学会伪装。
伪装，就算是伪装的顺从，如果能伪装一辈子，也不失为一件好事。家长们都有接受电击的思想准备，家长们都可以接受伪装顺从，家长都不怕，我怕什么？我告诉你，无论我用什么方法，哪怕是我求助一个孩子，都是功德无量的事情。
不可能伪装一辈子，绝不可能。你所有的一切都是建立在电击之上的，离开了电击，你的网戒中心，你的有心模式就什么也不是。
你敢挑战有心模式，看来你也需要治疗。
不好了，杨主任，有刺客，有个牛头盗贼潜入网戒中心，企图放走盟友和你的后宫。
好大的胆子，先把看你妹给我关起来。
看你妹，识时务者为俊杰。骷髅党真正的头儿是谁？你招还是不招？
庸人，我不谢你。所谓头可断，发型不能乱，血可流，意志不能丢。我们骷髅党的意志是用钢铁铸成的，也有20圣战日牺牲的同志们，他们的精神一直鼓励着我，鞭策着我。今天如果我招了，我有何脸面面对我胸前的红领巾？这是用骷髅党先烈的鲜血染红的。
应试文写得不错，那我先饿你几天，让你好好考虑考虑。
饥饿的痛苦和受尽镰刀的严刑拷打，与为了骷髅党正义事业而英勇牺牲的洛卡米尔、纵火犯、安妮莫奈、一杯酒他们相比，又算得了什么呢？我会用实际行动实现我的入党宣言，为骷髅党翻身做主人而奋斗。你有什么招就直接来吧，我不会饥饿，没有面包我就吃蛋糕。
你想快点死，我就成全你。明天我会在13号室为你亲自进行行为矫正，等我用 DXRA 抱你去花的时候，我看你能撑多久。
电不死人的， Snake 被电过，雷电也被电过，连 Big Boss 在核心装备三里都被电过。蓝猫说过电不死的，看看
蓝猫，
学蓝
猫，
我有知识我自豪。
我的好，我的好，我的好，我的好，我的好，我的好，我的好，我的好，
怎么可能电不死？妈的，我还是个处牛呢，明天就要被躲猫猫了。哎，生在国夫，死在国夫，真是祸不单行啊！
哼，死处牛！
这声音好熟啊，你是谁？
一年前的春风城，你偷走水产之书的事，难道不记得了？
是你呀、啊！你！
别你的，本小姐有名字。
你叫什么？
不告诉你。哼。你进来做什么呀？喂，你要干什么？
小姐，这个炉石是你掉的不？
太老套了吧。
哎， NGI 上都用这一招。
没出息。我叫贝利丁，叫我贝利就好了。
贝利，嘿，好亲切的名字呀。
你搭讪天赋没点过呀？
哎，我不是光棍宅男吗？哎，等等，贝利，你为什么会在这里？
还不是因为你，我没能拿到水产之书，九村开不了巫妖王，就把我解雇了。
可水产之书是虚无的，那天我手一碰到，水产之书就化成光烟了。
哼，当然是虚无的，九村根本没有想要开巫妖王，所谓的水产之书只不过是借舅舅之口放出来转移玩家注意力的东西。
什么？那些号称全知全能的舅舅把整个 NGI 都给骗了？
是啊，九村和板书大神的关系向来很好，之前的水产也就是骷髅长肉，那只是萌化大神和板书大神较量下的结果。 但自从一笔大神入股九村以来，九村就成了一笔牵制暴雨大神的一枚棋子。
啊，怎么这么多大神啊？
笨，直接点名会被跨省的呀。你以为打官司很便宜啊？
那倒也是。那你怎么会被抓到这里？
我本想把你救出去，让你去 NGI 揭穿九村水产之术的骗局，借此报九村解雇我的一箭之仇。可是我潜入网界中心的时候，听到被电击的惨叫声，还看到那些因为害怕放弃尊严下跪的孩子们，我的心就软了。我想把他们都救出去，被杨叔的人发现了。
我靠，你身为一个盗贼，三天两头被抓，太不专业了。你是要我吐槽你吗？
你还说我明天也要被送进十三号室，你知道吗？要不是为了救你，我怎么会连恋爱都没谈过就要被自杀？
嘿嘿嘿嘿，你也是啊。
笑什么，我死之前也要先把你杀了。
当时那把匕首离我的喉咙只有0.01公分，但十分之一张点卡之后，这把匕首的女主人将会彻底的爱上我。因为我决定说一个实话，虽然身为骷髅党政委，生平在 NGI 说了无数的实话，挨了无数的镰刀，但是这一次我觉得是最真诚的。
贝利，你应该这么做，我也应该死。曾经有一次去台服的机会摆在我面前，我没有珍惜。当巫妖王延迟一年的时候，我才追悔莫及。人世间最痛苦的事情莫过于此。你的匕首在我的喉咙上割下去吧，不要再犹豫了。如果上天能给我一次再来的机会，我会对那个母牛说五个字，和我一起去。如果非让我在现在买月卡的话，我希望是10000张。
怎么，你怎么突然提到私奔？你这死鬼。
Yes， 真正的告白让他心动了。什么都别说，先让爷亲一个。
别，我牙都还没刷呢。
那你刷牙，我研究一下怎么从这里逃出去先。这个炉石好像是一个工程学遥控器呢。
看你妹，你要先吃饭呢，还是先洗澡，或者是先吃我呢？
哎，你的感觉怎么上来的这么快？
没办法，剧本就是这么写的。
那接下来要做什么？
上床啊。
不是吧，这么快？
怎么，你怕啊？
谁怕呀？
大家都没经验，反正明天就要被电死了，现在这么闲不上床做什么？
这些都是剧本写的。
对啊，我看一下啊。剧本这里有一行黄字，看你妹，这是补偿你被关了一年的福利，性感玉米。
我靠，狗日的玉米，你对我太好了。嘿嘿，下一个圣战日我一定帮你追 K 姐。
可这部视频不是全年龄阶段的吗？就算赶成骑兵，咱一没名气二没厂牌，得找耐克那样的大神级别发片才能红啊。
那就是导演的事了，来吧。
哎呀，你讨厌，别这么粗鲁嘛。
哎呀，你真啰嗦。
杨白带
大神，我们一大开服了。
妈了个逼，丁三十居然敢擅自公然开服，
是萌化大神在给他撑腰。
操，小萌，当年无穷的任务的老账还没来得及算，现在还敢让他开服。既然网易自作聪明强行上网，我们现在就去金爱牙，去把他们的三通小霸王给关了。
什么？敢停哥的网？妈的小马，之前搞游戏那一展害哥这边没人来，现在又对哥的事儿粗暴干涉，必须给哥停职。我们现在就去金爱牙，想停哥的网，先从哥的尸体上跨过去。
你们居然让看人类给跑了，知不知道媒体现在正在搞我们？万一看人类把我们这事抖出去，消灭骷髅党的计划就会彻底失败，跑得了出力，跑不了武力。我们现在就去加压，对看你们进行跨省追捕。
日强，丁三十呢？
为了能让广大玩家早日玩上巫妖王，我们老大不辞辛苦，千里迢迢去告官拜神。
巫妖王？你还好意思跟我提巫妖王？你们当初的承诺呢？
哼，当初承诺的三通是通水、通电、通煤气吧？
你们承诺的没有外挂呢？黄金锄头挂机带链的不管就算了，还乱封号。
承诺的四周年熊宝宝呢？
我们有特意准备翡翠珍珠避孕虎啊。
日妈哪个稀罕咯？你不是说是潮的吗？三通小霸王不见了，你们就是被修空调的三轮拿走了。这招九水流烂了，你们他妈还在用？你们是 GM 效率变高了，还是开物联网速度变快了？你们接手之后就是看见了无数的盒子、热水和面粉袋。你们网易只比九水强在不忘关注。
我们想开巫妖王发自真心啊，我们被人暗算了。各位不如多练几个小号吧，多玩玩 TBC 又不会怀孕，有消息我们会派舅舅告诉大家的。
舅舅舅舅估计太复杂了，只装人了。姓舅舅买他妈不如姓春哥。你们那帮运营商啊，关门放舅舅那招已经死得出神入化了。你们扯起理由来，那就像贵族那帮废物，要么草皮太干，要么草皮太死，要么草皮不干不死。当初信你们网易，真是瞎了我的氪金狗眼。
会长
，shut up！ 房价高，足球臭，还不让老师玩魔兽？等那么久了，黄金魅力号都退役了，擎天柱都变毁伤者了 ，AC 房都开始下广告了，连阿胶都复出了，乌阳还没跟我开，非要我等到福建尼泊把全职那段花完那天吗？等得到吗？我国服我二逼啊！你走。顺便把两名姐姐都带走，等看你妹回来，我们公司集体转战台服。
会长，你要对国服有信心啊！
信心？国服就是一张茶几，我们玩家都是茶几上摆的杯具，和谐的阳光打在脸上，每个杯具都笑开眼。快走，看到你们都烦。
会长，
看你妹，哈，你总算回来了。
会长，水产支书那个事儿
不用说了，我都晓得，回来就好。各位，我们收拾一下，集体跨海去玩巫妖王。
看你们，你以为你们跑得掉吗？
杨主任，
杨教授，
不光看你妹跑不掉，你们这帮沉迷魔术吸毒的家伙一个都跑不掉，全部给我抓起来。
杨永兴，你的钱已经赚得够多了，还不肯善罢甘休吗？
哼，我是为了救你们，你们都沉迷了，这是病，得治。
治病？杨永新，我们是玩着游戏长大的一代人，这么多年来人变了，游戏也变了，可我们对游戏的喜爱没有变，我们玩家群体在这个社会中的弱势地位也没有变。当我们累了一天，打开那扇月租2000块的房门，却面对的是一个如此激进的版本时，我们的心里只有就像你，杨永新，你天天叫嚣着魔兽世界让我们沉迷。没错，我们沉迷了。可我们沉迷的不是游戏，而是游戏给我们的那种归属感。我们沉迷的是这四年来的朋友和感情，是这四年来的眷恋和寄托。这一年里，即使是这样的一个畸形版本，我们还在坚持。这一年里，我们每次点天赋，都会想着什么时候能再多十点。这一年里，我们每次到游岸，都会看到对面那座永远没有飞艇停靠的塔楼。这一年里，我们明知不可能，却仍不知疲倦地向北极游过去，游到地球的边缘，游到连海都没有的地方。可我们还是看不清那片冰冷的土地。在这一年里，我和其他热爱这个游戏的人一样，认真地挤着公交车上班，认真地消费着各式各样的食品，不管里面有没有不认识的化学成分。我们没有因为工资微薄而抱怨过，没有因为你们拿着从我微薄工资里扣的住着连体排污而心里失衡过。在这一年里，我和其他热爱这个游戏的人一样，为水灾、为地震而痛心哭泣，为载人航天、为奥运会而加油喝彩。我们打心眼里就不想我们在任何一个方面落后于这个世界上的任何一个民族，而这一年里却因为你们这些人，我们迟迟不能与地球上其他国家的玩家一起一决高下。为了真心喜爱的游戏，我们委曲求全，我们被迫离开，我们冒着被封号的危险去美服欧服，他们骂我们是金币农民，我们顶着上万的延迟去台服，他们说我们是大陆蝗虫，这些何其贬低的称谓我们都在默默地承受。我们凭什么就不能拥有每小时4毛钱的廉价娱乐？就凭我在国服，凭我是国服的魔兽玩家吗？你们从小就对我灌输金窝银窝，不自个狗窝，那现实呢？
你们已经让我只能暂住在自己的国家，难道我精神上的家园连暂住在自己的国家都不行吗？操你妈！你们这帮狗日的，我操你妈！
说得好，但这毫无意义。你声音再大又能怎么样？我背后的力量轻而易举就能把你们所有玩家的声音淹没。
岂能因声音微小而不呐喊？拜你们这些专家教授所赐，现在的藏歌分治麻药还不够多吗？你们除了每天无所事事养尊处优，就只会站在道德的制高点上对我们指手画脚。你们想过500万玩家一起吸毒的客观情况和这背后所掩盖的深层次社会原因吗？专家不说实话，教授不说实话，我来说，我们骷髅党来说。
对，我们骷髅党来说。
看你妹，原来你就是骷髅党的领袖。
杀了他！
看我无火球神教真传！去死吧，杨永信！秘法万无！
你就这点能耐吗？啊！是你们，
武哲叔，
看你们快站住嘴！
贝利，
还有你，你们都给我去死了！
杨永信，
今天就是你们骷髅党的末日。知道你们这帮魔兽玩家面对的是多么可怕的力量了吧？
可你面对的是人民战争的汪洋大海。
汪洋大海，那就让你们看看你们这些平民的汪洋大海在绿霸的力量面前是多么的不值一提吧。
所有在看这个视频的魔兽玩家们，我是看你妹，请举起你的手，我需要你们的力量。我知道他们杀丘突鳖的时候你没举，他们封推特的时候你没举，他们杀范否的时候你也没举。现在我们有可能连魔兽世界也失去，我也知道我们都是屁民，在老太碰瓷、捞尸卖钱、飞车撞人、钓鱼执法面前，我们做什么也救不了心爱的游戏。但至少你可以在电脑面前举起你的手，并把你的声音、你的力量通过这局域网传给我，为了我们仅有的精神家园一起高喊，我们是魔兽玩家，
魔兽玩家，魔兽玩家，魔兽玩家，魔兽玩家，魔兽玩家，魔兽玩家。
所有的人都已麻木，都已心死了吗？
没用的，看你们心里出来的孩子是没有勇气反抗我们的。接招吧，和谐电击。
但我不会怜悯你。
看你妹，不要以为你打败了我就打败了绿霸，打败了这伟大的和谐之力，我死不了。我的精神，我的意志，只要绿霸还存在，就会有人继承。力量是你们玩家永远敌不过的。
小萌，
小板，你的两盒三箱并没有令哥感到意外，哥早应该把你和你那些畸形的盒子全部杀掉。
今天我就要终结你的统治，你的墓碑以及整个艾泽拉斯长肉的亡灵都将重新审批。
直视哥的双眼，感受哥体内的和谐之力吧！你们这帮乌合之众，休想碰到哥！
我得不到的，谁也别想得到！我要把你，连同整个艾泽拉斯世界一起毁灭！
这帮屁民的世界与哥何干？
蒙哥，你我实力相当，打起来谁也得不到好处，不如……
哎呀，我也正有此意呀！啊啊啊啊啊啊啊啊啊！
启动应急预案。
明白，请往幽妖魔法应急预案后面角兽列查询中。
又是互联网最佳的入门方式，必须尽早扼杀。
教授列查询完毕，终结者 EX2D 桃红胎全部能去启动中。任务目标，接替 EX2D 进行妖魔法网游，梦见更多的普遍家长，并从中获得尽可能多利益。警告，EX2D 支持率下降已接近零点。
永远会有87.53%的人支持我。只要互联网还在发出我们不想听的这些钟声，这场战争就永远不会停止。
I walk all alone on these streets I call home, streets of home.Streets of fear through the sidewalk cracks, time disappears. I was lost on my knees, on the eve of defeat, as I choked.Hear the sounds inside of you ring now.
I actually don't. I'm not a gamer. Actually, I only see the ripple of the event. Myself, I've seen this movie before. I can Google for you, but yeah, it's relating to the two what's it called the culture and publication are two government agencies. Yeah, and there's a couple of companies. Domestic companies that they are competing and fighting territories to get the profit, and then the user having a miserable experience. I can just generally say that there's a lot of references. I don't know. Yeah.
Any question about the poetry battle? The
conflict,
because it would be so easy to show a regular battle. Maybe that's what World of Warcraft is. I assume it's a PvP environment.
I noticed that not only from this film, but it's among the young Chinese internet players that it's this is a kind of showing the smartness and the wit of in many forums and that they using couplets or other forms of illiterate ways to express himself. Now this, I suspect it had a lot to do with all the Chinese kids that educated when they're early 3-4 years old, all these tongue poems and those parents are forcefully feeding them this type of sort of a literate education, and later on became very popular online, like who can come out the smartest thing to say, it's getting very popular. So online they're full of that kind of materials. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You will notice this film actually the was participated by over 100 people are using a lot of online existing materials. Yeah. So instead of using a game to battle a real thing, which you would think they do it, they're simply taking the online stories or smart talks, popular slangs or couplets that even resonate more in this particular the users or gamers. It's their inner culture. It happened a lot. And also it's actually full of humor too, which the real fight will not show.
Yeah. And what's the government response to this film?
That's a very good question. If speculate, not really happened. This film being submitted to a government official to say approval, say, can we show it online and public? The answer will be absolutely no, no way. But like many things happened on Chinese internet, and this is actually one of the examples, that it hit the internet, become a viral and a popular before the government censor can react on it. Yeah. By the time everybody noticed, it's already millions of pages and millions of people read it and post it everywhere. Yeah. That's one first reason that the censor could not immediately step in. Yeah. Because too popular, too fast. It didn't come out as a political signal at the beginning, but obviously it had that message in it. The second reason is that, it is at least framing the producer himself having said in the public interview that he didn't mean that this film went beyond of the gamers. It's made for the gamers and express themselves, but the resonance of the message in the broader context is beyond his own expectation. So in that sense, the government didn't let, didn't step on very hard. Yeah, it's actually, there's no clear evidence the government that stepped on it at all. Yeah, which is different than some of the other similar type of creations, but because the message is a little more edgy, like the video I show, and then they will be deleted later on. So this is the one right on that edge. It's actually survived, but it's essentially they're more or less touching on the same chord. But yeah, but this one, that's why this film is unique about it. It got a war. It's on the official newspapers on some of them. Yeah. If one second, it's a lot of slants and the events and the figures in the reference were subtly in the reference in the films are beyond the games. They are the social and political events in China, but it's everybody's experience. Yes?
I was just wondering what the state of play in World of Warcraft in China is now. I mean, obviously, a lot of people are going to the Taiwanese servers, and a lot of people are struggling on with this distorted vision of World of Warcraft, but what's going
to
happen with
China? I don't know. Again, that's actually I'm beyond my knowledge to answer that. Only general observation that it still continues and gaming is still a very, very, very important aspect. Yeah.
I just add if you're interested in finding out about all the references in the film, you can go to YouTube.
It's amazingly dense. The
every frame has multiple jokes and multiple references that will only make sense to an entire audience.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's completely over my head, but it's fascinating to look at.
It's really worth a serious analysis of the Chinese online culture, but not only on gaming. It's sort of a plug, but this is a similar. You don't have the thing. So there's a general term about this kind of online culture called grass meta horse culture. If you come to the China Daily Times, I have a particular section called grass meta horse lexicon, which compiles over 280 those kind of reference and terms that the online expressions, which sort of translated in English, but with the sort of explanation that what it's about. From the Harmony Society to Green Dam to a lot of those things that they're saying, but mostly on the political side of things. If I have one more point to add to this, this is also a typical internet, online, even gaming sort of phenomenon. It's collaboratively made it. It's the message and metaphors are towards the sort of existing already receptive audiences, but it's unexpectedly, it was much larger than he thought. But also the last speech, if you remember, it's all about Chinese education as well, ideological education and experience they grow up. And the fact that one dominant force was trying to putting them down, and then those little people has to aggregate their individual small voices together to make that resistance meaningful is the message of this film, but it's also something very, to me, it's very exciting but also very unique that in the Chinese internet that way. So that's why this film, to me, is a significant, not only on the gaming side, but also this the whole thing behind of it, very accurately, precisely captured that certain sort of this spirit of the internet pop culture and in the broader context in Chinese society.